God bless us. God bless us all, one and all. That's it. Well, good morning. It is great to be together. It is, you know, if you're at home today, thank you for inviting us into your room. And you can't see what I can see, which is a whole lot of unmasked people. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah. Yeah. So our policy is the COVID thing is still very, very real. If you know anyone who's suffering from it, you know that there's so much to pray about. It's still a very, very wicked virus. But if you have been vaccinated and have had time for that vaccination to take effect, we still encourage you to wear a mask, but if you have been vaccinated, you don't have to wear a mask. If you have not been vaccinated, we still encourage you to wear that mask and to still social distance. But if you have been, praise God, no mask. Isn't that wonderful? It's still out there, but by God's grace and the way that He has empowered science, there is some normalcy on the horizon. So I hear that they're even opening up the sports events next year and everything else. So if you're a college football fan, you've got a lot to look forward to. It's great. It's great. Well, we are so glad to have you here today. You'll notice something interesting here. I don't know how often you notice the color on the communion table here. The vestments is what we call that. They go along with the liturgical calendar, the church calendar, the things that happen throughout the year. Once a year, you'll see this beautiful red color. That is for Pentecost Sunday. You'll also see them repeated here in the flowers. Some folks are wearing red today. That is because today we celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said as he was leaving this earth, he said, I will give you the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, and he will be with you. And today is the day that we celebrate out of Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit came rushing down, came down straight down from heaven in tongues of fire. And from them forward, the church, believers in Christ, have had the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so we celebrate that today. You'll see it repeated in the themes of our liturgy this morning. If you haven't yet downloaded a bulletin at home, you can grab that. And you'll see these themes repeated as we celebrate God's gift of the Holy Spirit. Think about that as Ben leads us in our time of preparation right after we have our morning video for some more updates. God bless.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to New Hope Church. My name is Zach Eckenholz. I'm the Assistant Director of Student Ministry here, and I'm excited to welcome you on Pentecost Sunday. Today is also a special Sunday because we're going to be celebrating our seniors later on in the service. We'll be praying for them and just remembering some of the great times we've had with them over the years before they go off to college. Then I want to let you know that later on in the service, Pastor Mike will be sharing with us again from his series on the book of Jonah. I want to let you know that VBS is coming up. We're looking for volunteers. So if you'd like to volunteer for VBS, you can do so by going to our website, newhopefortmyers.org/VBS. If you're not able to be a volunteer with us, that's okay. We'd appreciate the prayer. If you could pray for our team that's planning it and pray for our volunteers, that would be really great. Then I want to let you know about four unique ways that you can give to New Hope Church today. First, you can text to give, or you can give online. You can see how you can do those on your screen right now. Then you can also mail us a paper check in the mail with the address that you see on your screen. Or if you're with us today on a Sunday morning, you can go to the white boxes you see as you leave the lobby. Also, we'd love it if you go to our website and click on the contact tab. In the drop-down menu, click on friendship tab, because we want to know if you're joining us, whether you're here in person or online this morning. So let us know that you're here, fill that out, and we'd love to get to know you a little bit better going forward. Well, that's it for today. We are super excited to have you here with us. I'm going to pass it on over back to worship. God bless.
Lord our God, who calls us to worship him, to delight in him, and to find our greatest joy in him. Join me in this call to worship, which is a prayer from the Celtic Church. O Holy Spirit, on Pentecost, you descended on the apostles as tongues of fire. Take away all vices from our hearts and fill us with all wisdom and spiritual understanding. O blessed Spirit, with the Father and the Son, you live and reign, ever one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Father, Lord Jesus, we thank you and praise you this day for the gift of the Holy Spirit. It was the Spirit, you, Holy Spirit, that at the beginning you hovered over the waters and you brought beauty and order out of chaos. And by your Spirit, Lord, the prophets and the apostles spoke and acted in faith. You clothed them in power to become bearers of your word. By your Spirit, we believe the gospel. And without life and faith in Jesus, we would still be dead in our sins. Gracious Father, by the Spirit, we hear you calling us your dearly loved children. And by him, we hear and we learn more of the grace and the glory of Jesus. And so we lift our hearts to you in the power of the Holy Spirit. Loosen our hearts and tongues to show forth your praise. One God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. To the Lord Jesus, what do we believe? We believe in God the Father Almighty. We believe in Jesus Christ, his Son. And we believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe in life after death. We believe in our resurrection. Amen.
Hello, everyone. My name is Zach Eckenholtz, and I'm the Assistant Director of Student Ministry here at New Hope Presbyterian Church. Today, we want to take some time to celebrate our seniors and pray for them before they go off to college this fall. Some of these students have been with us since they were kids, and others have recently joined our church and have quickly become a part of our New Hope family. I am so grateful for the time I've had with this amazing group of students. They have challenged me and our leaders with questions that I wasn't even asking at their age. Our seniors were the ones who encouraged me to teach series on our God-given purpose, understanding eternity, false prophets, sanctification and justification, and so much more. Their deeply theological questions have helped me grow in my faith. It reminds me of 1 Timothy 4:12, which reads, "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." Our church is very blessed to have such a great group of seniors. They set an example for their younger peers and for their leaders. As we celebrate Pentecost this morning, we also celebrate these students as we send them off to carry out the Great Commission. I don't know exactly where God will take them, but I do know this: God will be with them every step of the way, and he has got great plans for each and every one of them.
Working with the youth. thank you for watching over these young men and women and guiding them to this point. Encourage them to put all of the knowledge they have gained into good use. But even as they go on to acquire more knowledge, we pray first, Lord, for wisdom. As they face uncertain times ahead, we pray that they hold on to the greatest wisdom of all, understanding that they are your masterpieces, each one of them created uniquely for a special purpose, with value beyond measure, not because of what they do, but simply because they are your children and able to approach your throne of grace because of what Jesus has done for them already. This chapter has closed, but the next lies just ahead. We pray that you inspire them to excellence in everything that they do. Help them to recognize and seize the opportunities you give them, and embolden them to live in ways that reflect your love into the world around them and cause others to see you clearly through them. And so, Lord, we ask that you continue to bless these graduates and their families with love, protection, mercy, strength, and wisdom. May they live lives that bring honor and glory to your name each and every day. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. And all those who care about you so much said, Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Our call to confession is taken from the Gospel of John, chapters 3 and then 16. Do not marvel that Jesus says to us, "That which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. It is the Spirit who convicts us of sin and leads us into all righteousness." So let's confess our sins to the Lord, both privately after a corporate time of confession. O breath of life, come sweeping through us. Revive your church with life and power.
O breath of life, come, bless us, renew us, and fit your church to be this hour.
O wind of God, come bend us, break us, till humbly we confess our need of you. O breath of love, come breathe within us, renewing thought and will and heart.
Come, Lord Christ, afresh within us, to revive your church in every heart.
O heart of Christ, once broken for us, 'tis there we find our strength and rest.
Our broken and contrite hearts now seek yourselves,
that your waiting church people. Church, hear again the gospel. There is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you.
We have the opportunity as we gather as a church to not only gather to worship, gather to learn, gather to fellowship, but also gather to give. God has blessed us in so many different ways. He has blessed us financially. He has blessed us to live in a country of opportunity. He has blessed us by his Holy Spirit, who calls us to call him Abba Father. And he asks that we give him our tithes and his offerings. We are much looser in many ways than we have been in the past with the whole virus. We're still not yet to the place where we feel comfortable passing the plate, but we would ask that you take advantage of one of the four ways that we have that you might be able to give your tithes and your offerings to the church. There are boxes. They look almost like mailboxes on the way out, on both of the walls on the way out. You can drop your your tithes and offerings in there. You can give online. You can text to give. And there is a fourth way that I can't recall right now. You can mail it in as well. Good old-fashioned, write a check and drop it in the mail. And so we would ask that you would seek the Lord as to how he would have you to give. Would you stand together as we sing our hymn of preparation?
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. I tell you, when we pull up those familiar hymns like that, I have to be careful because I've got a lot of preaching to do today, and I could blow out my voice just singing those great hymns. Thank you all so much. And as the choir exits, I would like to thank you all personally and individually for all that you have done through our season to enhance our worship together. I understand this will be the last formal time for the choir until the season begins again in September, but we do thank you so much for all that you have done. Thanks for using your gift. So blessed, so very, very blessed with the music here. That's not only, I was mentioning someone earlier, it's not only traditional, but it's passionately traditional. In other words, there are many places that you could go that you could find a traditional service, but I tell you, in Fort Myers especially, I have never found any church or any group of musicians that attack our traditional with such true, deep-hearted, deep-seated, worshipful passion. And so we are blessed. We are so blessed. Yes. Well, this morning we are going to resume our look at the book of Jonah. And you know, Jonah is like it's almost like Easter. Everyone knows what happened at the end, right? When you stand up to preach an Easter sermon, it's kind of like, okay, we all know the story. And Jonah is in a way similar to that because we're all familiar with Jonah. We might have met him through a flannel board back in the day. It might have been through a video, or it might have even been through VeggieTales. Any VeggieTales folks that know about Jonah the prophet through VeggieTales? It's a very, very well-known and popular story, but if we take the time to get underneath the popular and really see what's going on, we can see that Jonah, the message of Jonah, is a message that is very pertinent to us today in 2021. It's a message that is very pertinent to the church today. It's a message that is very, very pertinent to each one of us all the way until today. Now, just sort of as a refresher, because we had a little of a break. Thank you so much for Pastor Mike Glodo being here last week. But we had a break between chapter 2 and now chapter 3. So just to sort of get us up to speed, chapter 1, everybody remember what happened? God says to go one way, and Jonah looked at God and said, I don't agree. Now, what that ended up being was that he ended up going the other way. But it's very easy to make the case that he, not only did he disobeyed because he disagreed. As he looked and he saw what God asked him to do, he said, I'm not going to do it because it doesn't make any sense to me. Why would I go and do, even if I know what you want me to, why would I do that? And again, as that message is so pertinent to us, as we look through the scripture, as we look through the written word of God, and we see things in there, and we go, I'm just not going to agree. I'm not going to disobey, but I just don't agree, and so I'm not going to follow through with what I know God is asking me to do. And that's exactly what happened with Jonah. He looked at the whole situation, and he says, well, if I go and do that, then this is going to happen, and this is going to happen, so I don't agree, so I'm going to disobey. I'm going to run the other direction. And very interestingly, as you read the first chapter, you see that God sends a storm to get Jonah's attention. Now, God has called him to go to a city of 120,000 people. We'll see more about that next week. And Jonah says, I don't care about those 120,000 people. But he's on a ship with these sailors who are also pagans, right? And he's on a ship with them, and they say, what do we have to do to save ourselves? What do we have to do? And you know what Jonah says? He says, throw me into the ocean. Throw me in the ocean and God will save you. Isn't it interesting that Jonah could care less about 120,000, but when he knew the people on the ship, when he got to know them, when he knew their story, when he saw their face, he was willing to give himself for them. How often do we make a them out of a whole group of people when we know some and God changes our hearts? And so we see that's what happened. And we saw last week, or Jonah 2, that Jonah hits the water And as soon as he hits the water, before he dies, he thought for sure he was dead, God sends a fish. Now, I would not like to spend any time in the belly of a fish. I don't mind eating the belly of a fish, but I don't want to be eaten by the belly of a fish. But isn't it interesting that Jonah never complains about the fish? Because he knows apart from the fish, he would be dead. There are times when God will send discipline into our life to get our attention so that we can get back to being what he has for us. And that's where we left Jonah. Jonah had repented. He had turned, literally turned from going one direction to turning to going where God had called him. And that's where we find Jonah today. Jonah chapter 3, God makes Jonah, the runaway prophet, into an army of one. We've been standing a lot, but let's stand in honor of God's word as we read Jonah chapter 3 together. Jonah chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let the people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his first anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. Father, we pray that you would bless your word in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, it's interesting. There's probably a common story for most of us, if not all of us. And the comic book characters have picked it up very, very well. All of us, when we were born, we want to be an army of one. We relate to those characters in the comic books that come in and see injustice and take care of it and knock it down and basically whip up on it. It might be Thor. I don't know. It might be Superman. It might be Batman. I don't know. All of us have that superhero, Batwoman, Supergirl kind of thing that we're like, oh, yes, yes, there's got to be someone who can go in and make a difference. Someone who can just go in and they've got the superpowers to go in and take over and change everything around. You ever think of Jonah as one of those guys? Jonah was used by God to overthrow the most powerful city known at that time. Now, if you go back and you look, you see that the city wall itself around the city of Nineveh was more than 7.5 miles long. If anybody was going to take out the Ninevites and the Assyrians, which that was their capital, they were the worst, baddest, and I do mean that, they were a horrible army, a horrible occupation force. They were like ISIS with the military might of the U.S. They were bad, bad, bad news. Everyone feared them. And to think that anybody could take down that city would take an army of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, just to lay a siege around the whole city. And then you'd have to wait them out. They were completely entrenched. Nineveh was the cultural capital of the known world. Nineveh was the business capital of the known world. Nineveh was the thought capital of the known world. Nineveh was like the New York or Paris of the day. And I can imagine Jonah walking through town singing, "If I can make it here, I'll make it." It was the New York of the day. It was the center of the known world at the time. How was that city going to be brought down? How was it going to be brought to its knees when God sent in an army of one? See, God turned Jonah into a city changer and into a world changer. I want to challenge you today to be thinking in terms of, what could God do with me? What could God do with you? What could God do with our church if we were to approach him and say, "God, use me as a city changer. Use me as a world changer. Use me as your servant to the people that you have called into my world." It may not be Nineveh, but it is a group of people. It's a group of influence. It's a group of place that you have placed me that I might be a world changer for them. But you know what happens? Along about the time we get 8 or 9, maybe 12 or 13, we stop reading the comics. We stop believing that we could possibly be a world changer. We start getting cynical and jaded, and we think, "Well, if I just get through with all my limbs and all my stuff, I've succeeded." And we lose that feel, that understanding that God could use us to make a difference. Dorothy Sayers said it this way, and she wrote this in the late 1970s, and yet it is still so pertinent to us today. She said this. She said, "The sin of our times now is not power-hungry materialism, and it's not the permissive spirit of lawlessness. Rather, it's the sin that believes in nothing, cares for nothing, seeks to know nothing, interferes with nothing, and therefore enjoys nothing, hates nothing, finds purpose in nothing, lives for nothing, and remains alive simply because there is nothing for which it will die." Is that not an indictment on so many? We have become so cynical that we believe that things just are the way they are. They will never change. And yet God calls us to be an army raised up. She goes on and she says, the crazy thing about this is that the more self-important I am, the less important, relevant, and significant I become. In other words, as I build my life around me and become more and more my own walled city, and I become more and more important to me, the less influence I have on those around me, and I become more and more and more less important, more insignificant. And so she goes on, she says, so here's the real question. Is there anything gripping your life? A cause which you are serving that you believe, if I live in accordance with this, it can change the world? Christian, if you don't have anything like that, you're going to find your heart and your soul shriveling up because you were called to be a world changer, because you were called to be something so much greater. So how can we come like Jonah, an army of one by God's power? We're going to see that it takes God's relentless grace, that it takes God's tornadic, isn't that a great word, calling, and it takes God's preemptive power. Let's just dive in, make sure we get through all of this. First of all, God's relentless grace. Jonah 3:1, it says this, and again, we know how the story ends. Let's step back from it and take it apart a little bit and just see the amazing progression that God used here. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. I'm going to give you some Hebrew words today because in my mind they expose this passage in a new way. The first word I want to give you is Shene. Everyone say Shene. You can say it at home too. Nobody can hear you. Shene. It means again. Again. In Jonah's case, it was a second time. In some of our cases, it's a third time, a fourth time, a fifth time. God's relentless grace keeps on calling. Have you experienced His Shene grace? Have you experienced that place where God, you made it very clear that you wanted me to follow you here, and I turned my back, and yet you were calling again and calling again and calling again. We serve a God of second and third and fourth chances, and He will call again. Shene grace. Have you experienced that? Or have you put up a wall and said, it's never going to happen? God will call you again and again for His purposes, for the people that He has brought into your life, so that you can be an army of one to bring the grace of Jesus Christ to those that God brings across your path, even if they are thems, even if they are those that you say, there is no way that I could ever, ever embrace them. God will bring them into your life, and He will give you that Shene grace to be able to speak to them again. Now, moving on from there, it says, go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim the message I give to you. I'll give you another couple of Hebrew words. You're gonna love these words. You're going to walk out of here and go, wow, wow. The word is kum yalak. I always say kum yalak. And you got to say it with a lot of K in the back there. Yalak. Kum yalak. And the reason that I bring that out, the kum is kind of like Zoom, which until a year ago, we didn't use that often. Now it's kind of like pretty popular, you know? Kum yalak. And I want to bring that out because it doesn't just say go. It says go now. In the Hebrew, He says go now before you change your mind. Go now before you get distracted. Go now and do what I have told you to do, and do it now. Let me ask you, in your life, what do you need to bring under kum yalak? What is God putting on your heart saying, go and do this now? And you've been saying, yeah, I know, I'll get around to that. What's that conversation that you need to have? What's that phone call that you need to make? What's that letter that you need to write? What's that boldness you need to step into? Kum yalak. Do it now. I love that this passage has come to us on Senior Sunday. Because seniors, it is so easy to get distracted, to think, well, I'll grow my faith after college. I'll get involved back in church after college. I will go ahead and I'll chase after all these other things, knowing that it's still there. And no, God says, kum yalak, take care of it now. You see, He told Jonah, he could have easily said, you know, Jonah, man, you've been traveling. I bet you're tired. You've been in the belly of a fish. You need to take a few days off. You need to kind of recoup here a little bit. Nineveh, it'll still be there. No, Nineveh was on a time. Remember the message that He brought? He said, 40 days. 40 days. There was a timeline there. God always has a timeline, and He may be calling you today to kum yalak something in your life, to go and to do it now. Who do you need to share the gospel with now? Who do you need to bring God's presence to now? Kum yalak. Now, what's interesting here, it's what Sinclair Ferguson calls the Jonah principle. Now think about this for just a moment. Jonah had just proven that he was willing to go the other way and to be completely disobedient and to basically throw a wrench in Nineveh's redemption plan, at least for a season. And yet God comes back to him, and He doesn't go to one of the other prophets. God comes right back to Jonah, and He says, Jonah, kum yalak, go now. God uses His people His way. But wouldn't you think that if Jonah has shown himself out to be resistant, that God would have moved on to the next one? Think about this. Think about this. When Jesus was betrayed, when Jesus was in the garden and all of his disciples deserted him, especially Peter. Peter denied him. Peter melted into the woodwork. And yet when Jesus comes back from the grave, who does he restore? Who does he go to? He goes to them, and he even goes to Peter. You see, the Jonah principle is that there is always life out of death. That failure makes you useful. So many times we want to be more like Jonah and say, well, God, I failed you. You could never use me. God, I messed up. There is no way that you could ever use me for anything. And God comes with his sine grace. And he gives us a second chance, or a third chance, or a fourth time. And he says, Zum yalach, kom yalach, go and go now. That is our God, a God of restoration, a God of restoring grace, a God who has a plan for you, for me, for his church in this world. In Matthew, Jesus references this. He says, they say, hey, Jesus, give us a sign, perform a miracle, do something so we can know for sure that you are who you say you are. And Jesus says, the only sign you'll receive is the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was in 3 days and three nights in the belly of a few huge fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. First thing we see is God's relentless call. God's relentless call on you and me and Jonah and his church throughout history. God's relentless call. But the second thing, we got to move quickly, is God's tornadic call. Tornadic call. You know what a tornado is? A tornado, some of you from the Midwest, and you're like, oh yeah, I know what a tornado is. I've been there, seen that. A tornado picks up things. It comes spinning through. It picks up things, spins them around, and puts them in a completely different place. That's what God's call does. You see, we can look at our problems. We can look at our situation. We can look at our sufferings. We can look at everything that's going on, and we have a choice. We can look at those things and we can say, God, that disqualifies me. I can't do anything with this. Or we can look at it and say, God, you're doing something in the midst of this spin, and you're going to spin me out somewhere over here, and you are going to use me. Tim Keller says it this way: suffering will either make you more self-absorbed and full of self-pity than ever before, or less, but it will not leave you where you were. How do we deal with suffering? How do we deal with pain? How do we deal with loss? How do we deal with these things that are part of life? Will we give them to our God and say, God, you can use this. Only you can use this. Or will we turn them away from God and say, oh, you couldn't have been there. Jonah, when he went into the city, We know from history and probably ideas, if you'd been in the belly of a fish for 3 days, you're not going to look the same. You are going to have blotchy skin because all of that acid is going to be on there. Some have speculated that all of his hair was burned off over his whole body. And I bet he didn't smell too good. He could have easily taken all of that and say, God, I stink. I'm ugly. You couldn't possibly use all of this. And yet God used it to get their attention. Where are you suffering today? Are you hiding that away from the world? Are you hiding that away from the uses of God? Are you bringing it before him and saying, God, I bring my entire life as a living sacrifice to you. Use it as you will. Probably 3 years ago now, I had back surgery. Oh my goodness, it was painful. But it was more painful getting to the point of needing the back surgery, right? And I went and I visited someone recently in the hospital, and she was about to have the very same surgery that I had had. And so when I was praying for her, I was praying very specifically, Lord, take away the nerve pain. Lord, take away the incision pain. Take away all these things. And when I finished praying, she said, how did you know how to pray like that? I said, because I've been there. I know because I've been there. What are you hiding from those around you that God would turn into a testimony? Revelation 2 says, well, they were saved by the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. What are you hiding that God is wanting to use redemptively? What is that tornadic activity that God has used to spin you out on somewhere else to go and speak life and truth? Well, on the first day, Jonah started into the city. And this will be one of our last Hebrew words, chalalbo, chalalbo. Say that together, try to. Chalalbo. Circle that word, started into the city. That word chalalbo means to untie or to loosen. And it could mean that as he stepped into the city, he was remembering Jonah 2:8, where he prayed, those who cling on to worthless idols lose the grace that could be theirs, forfeit the grace that could be theirs. He had to let go. He had to let go of his prejudice. He had to let go of himself. And actually, what we see is probably he was a pretty angry preacher as we look at chapter 4 next week. But he had to let go of himself to be able to enter the city and become an army of one and change everything by the power of God. What are you holding on to? What are you holding on to that is keeping you from being that army of one to the people around you? Are you holding on to expectations that are false? Are you holding on to an agenda? Are you holding on to anger? Maybe you're even holding on to unforgiveness to say, there's no way that I could ever forgive that person for what they have done. If any of that describes you today, I want to give you this verse, Colossians 3:14. It says, forgive. Forgive one another just as Christ has forgiven you. How much did he forgive you? Everything. What are we holding on to? What do we need to bring under the banner of Chalalbo? To let go, to open our hands, to say, God, use my suffering, use my past, use my testimony, even use these things that I have been holding on to. They're not worth it. I give them to you. I give them to you. Chalalbo. What needs to come under Chalalbo in our lives today? You see, we know that God is by nature ascending and a calling God. In Genesis 12, he calls Abram and he says, I'm going to send you somewhere different. And I'm going to bless people through you. God sent Jonah into somewhere different, and guess what? He blessed people through his messages. You see, God blesses you simply to make you a blessing. Simply to make you a blessing. And yet we hold on to so many things and we won't bring them under Chalalbo. Or we won't kumyalak them. We'll say, I'll get to it later. And God says, now, go now. Release them to me and let me use them. Those things that are so hurtful in your past, those things that you say, there's no way that I could ever, ever redeem those things. You need to bring them under the power of the Word of God. In 2 Corinthians, he says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the Lord, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. Who needs to hear God's comfort through you today? How can you be a world changer for someone today? It might be someone that you go, we don't have anything in common. How could I possibly speak to them? God has brought them into your life. He's built the relational bridge that you might be a world changer for them by the power of the Holy Spirit that we celebrate today. Amen. Amen. Finally, God's preemptive power. And I know we're running a little late. Jonah went and he had an 8-word message. 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. One more Hebrew word, hipkok. Hipkok. It has two meanings. The word hypcock means they can either be overturned and destroyed, or they can be overturned and changed. As he walked through the city, he said, you got 40 days. You can be overturned and destroyed, or you can be overturned and changed. Folks, we live in a world that needs to be overturned. We live in a world that needs to experience this hypcock. But will they turn, will they be challenged and destroyed, overturned and destroyed? Or will they be overturned and changed? By God's power, by God's grace, they were overturned and changed, even though it was just for a season. The book of Nahum, written 100 years later, talks about the destruction that will come on Nineveh, even though, as we see this, we see from the rest of the story that they did change. They were overturned and changed. The Ninevites believed God. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, and covered himself with sackcloth and sat down in dust. In other words, it got his attention. And he said this, by the decree of the king and his nobles, don't let people or animals, herds or flocks taste anything. Don't let them eat or drink, but let people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. What's the key here? I'll finish with this. What's the key here? Turn from their evil ways. It is repentance. It is repentance. That's not a word that we like to use very often, but repentance is not just an emotional upheaval. It's a thorough and ongoing change of life. It says, not only am I wrong, I'm going to stop what I was doing and do something different. Around 1860s, 58 to 64, somewhere in there, there was a huge revival, an experience of revival in the country of Wales. Kind of ironic that it was Wales and Jonah and the, but anyway, that's just thought of that fleeting moment. And what was interesting, you know, Wales was a mining country. There were a lot of coal mines, there were mines, and so everyone was employed somewhere in the mining industry, okay? And the word of the Lord started going forth and people were being converted. And even at the mines, they were having Bible studies and prayer times and men and women were coming to know Jesus. And you know what they had to do? They had to build more tool sheds. They built hundreds of tool sheds at these mines in Wales. You know why? Because when the Spirit of God gripped these folks, they repented and they brought back the shovels and the picks and the rakes that they had stolen for years and years and years. And as a result, the mines had to build hundreds of tool sheds to hold all of the tools that had been returned because of the Spirit of God causing repentance in their lives. Where do you need to repent today? That's not a word we use all that often. We love the word grace. We love the word forgiveness. But what about repentance? When the Spirit of God moved through Jonah and he pronounced an 8-word message by the power of the Holy Spirit and by the preparation of a preemptive God, they turned from their evil ways and turned in a different direction. It's easy for us as a country to see where we need to repent and, oh Lord, we need to repent. But where do you, where do I, where do we ask the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and say, God, I don't want destruction. I want to be confronted and turn to you. Where do we need that kind of repentance? Where do we need to experience the relentless grace of God our Father? The relentless grace shown through the story of Jonah, but brought to us, that we might become that army of one to the people that God has surrounded us with. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we recognize that We're a lot more like Jonah than we thought we were, but we also recognize that as your children, as your people, your Holy Spirit is working in us. Oh, God, thank you for that. Thank you that it's your Holy Spirit that illuminates your word. And so, Father, anything that I have said that's of me, I pray that it be forgotten before it even hits the brain cells. But anything of you, Father, would it penetrate our heart? Father, I pray for those of us today who have heard your word and realized that you are calling us to be an army of one to the people that you have surrounded us with. And so, Father, I pray that we would repent, that we would open our hands, that we would obey you, and we thank you that you give us the second chance to obey you. And so, Father, may all of these things be done for your glory. May they be blessed by your Spirit, and may they bring you honor in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together to sing our closing hymn. And now receive the benediction. May the love of God the Father, may the grace of God the Son, and may the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen and amen.